Hello, dear friends. Welcome back to another study of And Life Goes On, part of the series of Life in the Spirit World by the kind spirit doctor, Andre Lewis. Today, we are going to focus on chapter 15, entitled Time for Analysis. So far in our journey with Dr. Andre Lewis, we've learned about the life in the afterlife of Ernesto, Evelina, and now Tulio. Ernesto and Evelina are starting to learn to cooperate with God from the spirit realm. They are participating of their first spirit rescue mission, because they have now understood that since life never ends, it is important for us to put love into action no matter what dimension of life we are. We are fortunate as incarnate beings who know the spirit this lives of life because we can start now. Unlike Ernesto and Evelina, we don't need to wait until we discarnate to put love into action, because we know for a fact that life goes on no matter where we are. And now we are going to see Ernesto and Evelina reflecting upon their first rescue mission and encounter with Tulio, from an immortal perspective with the help of Instructor Rivas. So we'll have a lot to learn with Instructor Rivas today. And we would like to welcome Sunshine to our program, always allowing her light to shine from coast to coast. Thank you, Sunshine, for allowing your light to shine one more time with all of us.
Thank you, Carol. It's a pleasure. It's an honor to be here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Would you like to start our program, Sunshine, with a beautiful prayer?
Yes.
Thank you, Sunshine.
Let us begin with a prayer. And if you can, please close your eyes and open your hearts wide and your minds wide as well. And let us connect with God, our first cause of all things, and our beautiful guide and model, Jesus Christ. Let us also invoke Mother Mary, who's so lovingly dedicating herself to the most suffering in the universe. And let us pray that we will be present in body, mind, and spirit to incorporate, understand, and practice the lessons that the beautiful spirits on high so graciously are gifting us with. It is with immense gratitude and humility that we are celebrating God's and Jesus and everyone's beautiful, supportive energy for us to transform ourselves, to become more loving, to become more kind, to become more benevolent, more indulgent and forgiving. And with this, we ask for permission to start our morning radio program today. And so be it.
So be it. Thank you, Sunshine, for sharing so much light with all of us in our intercontinental classroom. Welcome, Rihanna from South Africa.
Hi, Rihanna.
She's also doing a beautiful program on Cardiac Radio. She's studying the book Letters from the Spirit World by the Spirit Carlos and the Spirit Nello. It's wonderful to have you, Rihanna. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Rihanna. Yes, and your beautiful daughter and granddaughter. What is life
Yes, they are
there?
reading our fire.
Awesome.
So precious to see the two of them working together, a whole family living a Christ-centered life and putting love into action. All our love to you, Brianna, and your family, right, sunshine?
Yes, definitely.
All
Much love from California.
right. Yes, from coast to coast.
Yes.
So now we shall start our reading of the book Time for Analysis. According to our master, instruction is paramount for our progress because the more we know, the more discernment we acquire. So let us feel the blessings that are coming from above and let us feel how the spirit mentors are investing in all of our progress. So let us start. Chapter 15, Time for Analysis. In answer to a request by Ernesto and Evelina, who were eager for an explanation with regard to the turmoil that Tullio's presence had caused them, Instructor Rivas made an appointment that they kept promptly. Within the institute's inviting atmosphere, the instructor listened patiently to what they had to say. Why was Tullio so troubled? How could they, especially Evelina, help him as he needed? Would it be fitting to ask the institute for any information concerning Mancini's accusation against Caius Serpa? Could they both take on the responsibility of helping the unfortunate young man? After hearing them out, their guide looked at them kindly and advised.
You have repeatedly asked for spiritual work. Don't find it strange if the time has come.
After a pause, he smiled.
Tullio Mancini is the starting point for the redemptive work you have embraced. Search your hearts, especially our sister Evelina, and see what kind of pity his difficulties cause you. Where love brings balance, our conscience does not trouble us. Where there is no guilt, there is no troubled conscience.
Oh, instructor, Mrs. Serpa pleaded, please tell me what I need to do.
I will talk to you as if you were my own children, because there should be openness between parents and children.
And changing his tone.
Sister Evelina, how did you feel when you were alone with our newly arrived brother?
Having promised herself that she would face the truth, whatever the consequences, the young woman admitted, "Well, when I found myself alone with him, with nobody watching, I went back into the past when I thought I had found in him the man of my life. I felt transported back to my youth, and then her benevolent mentor completed a reticent sentence.
Your own vibrations encouraged his aggressive affection.
But I suddenly remembered my commitment as a married woman, and I got a hold of myself.
You did well, but even so, your heart spoke without words, triggering a new wave of the emotional maladjustment that Mancini experienced during his earthly experience, due largely to your unfulfilled promises. Let us pause right here for a moment because he says she spoke without words, and we might be wondering, how is that possible? We always thought that our thoughts and our feelings, they are our private things, and nobody has any influence or nobody knows what's going on inside of us. And let us go to our beautiful instructor, Emmanuel. Emmanuel teaches us otherwise, and it is in the book Thought and Life, in the very introduction, where he is educating us, and he's saying, it is your thought process being a reflection of yourselves which creates the kind of life you're leading. And he continues on in chapter one, where he says, the mind stands as the mirror of life. So we're starting to get the idea that it is actually our thoughts and our feelings are not just our own private matter. As we think, we emit. And as we emit, we attract. So even if we don't say a single word, our feelings, our emotions, and our thoughts do ripple out. It is a magnetic field we create around ourselves, which influences and has an impact on other people. So there is no thing as whatever goes on in my mind is my own private matter, because it's always out there. We're influencing and we're being influenced. It's a two-way road. Right, Carol?
Right, sunshine. We are like a magnet. We attract what we emit. So today, at the Spiritus Society of Virginia, we were studying health, but health from an immortal perspective, also from the book Thought and Life. And there, Emmanuel tells us that one way to be healthy for immortality is to have good sentiments and good thoughts, because in this way we attract other minds that are on the same frequency, just like a radio station or a Wi-Fi connection. When we use our cell phones, we can connect automatically. Our cell phone joins the Wi-Fi networks around us automatically. And the same goes for our minds as immortal spirits. We will join whatever network is in the same frequency as ours. So we have a vibratory responsibility for what we emit. Light shine.
Yes, Carol.
So as Evelina realizes exactly that, she says, "Oh my God."
Don't fret about it. We are all indebted spirits before the divine laws, and we find ourselves in a period of significant transition, the transition from narcissistic love to selfless love. Shall we pause again, Carol?
Absolutely.
Yes, it's very important to consider narcissistic love versus selfless love. We actually looked up what narcissism, the definition of narcissism is, and it is the pursuit of gratification from vanity or egotistic admiration of oneself's idealized image. So it is a very self-centered form of going through the world. The person who is narcissistic needs excessive attention, feels very self-important, and lacks empathy for others, which we can already gather is the opposite of selfless love, which is love that's regardless of personal needs. It is completely empathic. It is without expectations that something comes back to us. It is the exchange of divine qualities in a partnership. And to this matter, there is a chapter in Nosalar where we find the most beautiful, and Carol, you mentioned it. I pulled it up, and with your permission, I would like to quote that. Is
Please
that?
do, please.
Yeah, it's in this beautiful, it's the first book by André Louise, and you'll find it on page 110. And it just really opens our hearts and minds to what true love is. What is non-narcissistic love, which is really no love, right? Well, the definition we receive is love. It's based on love one another. And of course, that's one of the commandments that Jesus gifted us with. And it says it's the practice of the good, and it consists simply in fulfilling our duty. Jesus also counsels us to sustain one another through fraternity and sympathy. So those are two attributes of true love, fraternity and sympathy. Someday incarnates will understand that friendly words, gestures of kindness, mutual trust in the light of understanding, and fraternal interest, all treasures that naturally originate in profound love, are the solid nourishment of life itself. Our whole entire universe is sustained by love, consists of love. We're all nourished by love, by this form of love, by doing the good, by being benevolent, kind, indulgent, forgiving. Right, Carol?
Right, Sunshine. How beautiful to know for a fact now that we are nourished by love. And every time we practice a thought that is loving, or we emanate a feeling that is loving, or we act in a way that is loving, we are also co-creating with God. We are offering of the nourishment that we receive from God. And the more we give, the more we shall receive the law of action and reaction. This is why Mr. Rebus is pointing that very law to Evelina. He was saying that Tulio behaved in a certain way because Evelina provoked it first through her thoughts. So even though she was silent, she was provocative. So this is why our Master Jesus recommended that we get to know ourselves. A good exercise that we can do is to study our mental field, to log our thoughts and feelings that are most common, and think about how much we are devoting our mental and heart activity to love. If we find thoughts and feelings that are not loving yet, we can practice to transform them or replace them until the percentage of loving thoughts and loving feelings go up. That's why we are reincarnated, to be trained in our ability to become one with love. Because as you said, Sunshine, love nourishes us.
Right, Carol. Exactly. Carol, it is a little hard to hear you.
Oh, okay.
Somehow it's not all clear. I just want to say
Thank you. Can
one
you
of
hear
our
me a little better now?
It's a little muffled. I don't know, maybe the microphone, whichever microphone you're using might be a little bit more closer to you. I don't know. It's a little
bit better now.
We'll see.
Thank you, Sunshine.
Welcome, Carol.
So Master Rebus is going to continue teaching us, right?
Yes. So he says, we have theories of sanctification regarding our sentiments, but in essence and in practice, we are just beginners. In the sphere of noble thoughts, we absorb the influx from the higher realms. But in the ambit of inferior tendencies, we still carry the immense burden of demeaning desires that constitute strong appeals holding us back.
Amazing instruction here. Then, in fact, Fachini commented, this means that the earthly human is an intelligent being refined by abilities acquired along the road of evolution. Hi, sunshine.
Yes,
Take it away.
what was that?
Take it away.
It has traveled for many centuries, but in general, it is still wavering between animality and humanization, despite the special cases of some who are already on their way from humanity to angelhood. Most of us spirits still enrolled in the School of Earth have switched from polygamy to monogamy with reference to sexual conduct. Hence, the need for self-vigilance, knowing that sex is a creative faculty in the realms of body and soul. Wow, what an amazing paragraph. So rich of information. Right, Carol?
Right.
The first thing is the difference between polygamy and monogamy, which polygamy we can connect to animality. It's a form, a version of animality. And monogamy, when we're monogamous, we are becoming closer, we're reaching humanization of our sentiments, of our passions. And this is due to the law of progress. So our timeline, so to speak, we're moving from being more animalistic to becoming more human. And part of that is we're moving away more and more from polygamy to monogamy. And Allan Kardec was wondering about that in the Spirits book. And he asked in question 695, is marriage contrary to the law of God? Because it's in marriage, within marriage, that we're called to practice monogamy. And the spirits on high answered, it represents progress in the evolution of humankind. Why is it progress? It is because, as we just said earlier, we are moving from being more animalistic, more polygamous, to becoming more human, which is more monogamous. And the institution of marriage is helps us with that. It's like a it's Yeah, it helps us with that. It's in quite in the next question that Allan Kardec then wonders, so what effect would abolishment of marriage have on society? And we're wondering too, how would that look like? And the answer is it would help us to return to the life of an animal. So we would move back to the infancy of our humanhood, so to speak. So it is important to cherish, to know what is behind marriage, what is behind the striving for becoming more monogamous. Right, Carol?
Right, sunshine. It's a spiritual commitment to our own evolution. So, marriage is an opportunity, like a course we take in school, for us to be trained for immortality, to reach another level in our evolution. So, every partnership we have on earth is a gift from God. As God intends to train us for us to progress in new qualities. But the question is if we lead a self-centered marriage or a God-centered marriage. If we lead a self-centered marriage, then we look to be served. We say, oh, I hope my partner does the dishes tonight because I'm very tired. I hope my partner has dinner ready. I hope my partner reads my mind and gets me flowers because, of course, if this person is really my partner, I don't even need to say what I want. My partner will find out what I want. I actually know of couples that behave in this way. I will not tell my partner what I need or want because it's their job to guess. So this is more along the line of a self-centered marriage, a more God-centered marriage would be like, how can I serve my partner in my training to practice selfless love? My partner is not mine. My partner is my brother or sister in evolution. Let me see how I can learn to serve this brother and sister more. Let me see what eternal qualities I can cultivate in myself so I can balance out this partnership. That would be a God-centered marriage. Why did God put me in this marriage? What is it that I need to learn? Versus, how is it that my partner is going to read my mind? Right? Thank you, Alice. They mentioned something about that. Oh, it's fine. Okay. Thank you, Alice. Okay. So, yes, not only are we moving to progress, towards progress from animality, but through spiritism, we are invited to take our progress to another level and lead a God-centered relationship or God-centered relationships, not only in marriage, but in all aspects of our lives. This is what our master has come to teach us. Right, Sunshine?
Yes, and it's important also to remember that sex is just an instrument. It is not love per se at all. And in our culture, we often get confused about that. Sex has its place, and it is necessary for procreation if it's combined with love. But we need to also educate ourselves about the place that sex has. And one amazing example that we're gifted with in Missionaries of Delight is when André Louise and his team go into this obsession meeting, and they're observing a young man who was promiscuous. He was someone who used sex overly and did not attach it or did not bring it together with love. So he was not using it as a sacred instrument. And the result of that, and this is interesting and important for us to also remember, is that our physical health, our emotional, spiritual health is impacted by that. Because what happened is this man had psychic bacilli attached to his sexual organs, and they created incredible balances on all levels in his being. And he was tormented because he was tormented by a feverish hunger for more and more sex. So we're never alone in whatever we're doing. And there is spirits, and as we learn now, psychic bacilli who attach themselves to us, which is something we need to be aware of so that we can see another level of why it is so important to rein in our passions and become more and more monogamous.
Exactly.
To really see the power that sex, misguided, misplaced sex has.
Exactly. Thank you, Sunshine. Very important reminder for all of us as we educate ourselves. Also in the book, Sex and Destiny, we see André Louis, the same spirit doctor, telling us the account of Nemesio and Marina. They are having an extramarital affair, and as they go on their encounters, they think they are alone, but André Louis describes the many, many vampire spirits who are together with them in the sexual act, actually taking energy away from them, draining them, and using them as well. So we are never alone, and the creative energy is a creative and divine energy that shall be used with respect for ourselves, our physical bodies, and the physical bodies of others, and the spirit with whom we interact. both on the incarnate realm and the discarnate realm. Andrea Lewis tells us that we have responsibility over the partners that we decide to have, eternal responsibility. So we shall, as spiritists, make an effort to use the creative energy wisely. It's important even to pray before this sexual act. Mentor Joseph here at the Spirit Society of Virginia has asked all of us to pray that, so that we attract the protection of the mentor spirits for an act that shall be sacred. Right?
Thank you, Carol. Beautiful. Yes. Very, very good reminders.
Yeah. So much to learn. So
yeah.
We shall continue. However, showing that he didn't mean to avoid Evelina's specific problem, he added,
"It's understandable that you felt attracted as you did, Evelina. And your self-control is commendable because you called upon clear and responsible reasoning to curb your immature heart. No one reaches the port of inherent dignity without having sailed for a long time in the currents of life, learning how to handle the rudder of discipline. Therefore, we have to take responsibility for the errors we perpetrate concerning our sentiments in order to purify or redeem them at the appropriate time."
I'm really indebted to Tulio. I made so many promises in the past, but left him empty-handed, sighed Mrs. Serpa disconsolate.
"That's right. Tulio has committed many blunders up to now. Even so, your conscience as a woman won't exempt you from your responsibility in the matter."
"How can I pay my debt?"
"By helping him cleanse his emotions as one purifies the waters of a muddy well."
Not noticing the apprehension that had come over the young woman, he added,
"Don't be hasty or forceful. We must accept ourselves for what we are and face the problems caused by our mistakes. We don't seek enlightenment in order to weep. You're perfect. You're perfectly aware of your role in our friend's moral failure. Let's take a calm look at what you can do to help him get back on the right path."
"Insignificant as I am, what could I do?" asked Evelina humbly. Rebus went over to a large piece of furniture resembling a complicated file cabinet and took out a folder. He explained to Evelina that it contained a summary of the information she gave upon her first contact with the Institute. He then explained that having studied the material she had provided on the events that had tormented her life, he had obtained supplementary information concerning the pathway she had chosen to tread. As such, he had learned that Mancini had, in fact, lost his physical body, due to Mr. Serpa's criminal act, and that her husband had indeed deceived the human authorities with a perfect crime, which is skillfully made to look like a suicide. The victim of a premature discarnation, the young man was just like a sleepwalker. He had aimlessly wandered around for some time on the earthly stage where the tragedy had happened. Sometime later, he had been taken to the same city of Virginia celebration and renewal where they were now studying his situation. He had coalesced there for a few months. However, the passion that Evelina had irresponsibly inspired soul made her the object of his thoughts. Let us pause there for a moment. It's interesting that instructor Rivas do André Luiz is telling us that this is a passion which she irresponsibly cultivated. So what are we to take from this passage? That we are responsible not only for our own sentiments, but for the sentiments that we cultivate in others. Everyone we meet is like a divine plant that God grants to us, and whose perfume we are here to admire. And God is counting on us to be like a gardener and help a person achieve or cultivate their highest qualities. So when in a relationship we instead go towards the person's lower qualities or lower instincts, which we all have, rather than focus on their higher selves, then we are being spiritually irresponsible because we are not in anyone's life by chance. We don't encounter partners from the past to stimulate past tendencies. Quite the contrary, we reincarnate to renew ourselves and to create new tendencies. So when we just casually relate to one another, thinking that we are being neutral according to the immortal laws that guide the universe, there's no such thing as neutral because we are all here to support one another to evolve to a higher level. So when we think that we can just pass by each other's life and leave no mark, we don't yet understand the eternal consequences of our actions. So we are lucky here, dear friends, that we are learning that we need to be responsible for each other's souls as well, to act responsibly, not only for our own sake, but for the sake of others. Right, Sunshine?
Yes, Carol, it's so important. And in learning this responsibility, increasingly, our passions play such a great role in that. Because passions are really a wonderful thing when we use them for the good. But passions can also lead us terribly astray. And the illuminated spirits give us a beautiful picture in the spirits book by saying that passions are like a horse. They're useful when we do the controlling, but they become dangerous when the passions control us. And that again brings us then closer to our animal nature. And that is the very thing that we are in the process of moving away from. So knowing about this principle, it will help us to become more responsible.
Exactly. Yeah. Also in the book Sex and Destiny, we see the case of Beatrice. Beatrice in a past life had been seduced by Alvaro. And Alvaro, once he got tired of her, he developed a whole plot to rid himself of her. Fast forward 100+ years, Beatrice still suffering the consequences of that action, as is Marcia, his partner, and other partners that he had had in that life. So in that life, he thought that he could just serve himself and not think of any consequences. 30 years later, he's still dealing with the consequences of not being emotionally responsible for his partners or emotionally charitable, giving to his partners what he would like to receive. He had to reincarnate yet again to be able to meet his partner in the position of her grandson, to be able to reinstitute balance to her heart. So what we think is a passing action that we can just do whatever we want is not so before the laws of the universe. Every action has a reaction. We are free to act, but we must reap the consequences. Right? Yes. So let us continue here. Consequently, Tulio had lost interest in getting better and then ended up fleeing towards the dreadful zone of uncontrolled behavior, where he had surrendered to all kinds of motives connected to the young woman who had needlessly promised him such dreams of blessedness and affection. He had corrupted himself in the land of darkness and had disregarded his own respectability. By returning to the resting place of consolation and equilibrium as a result of once again meeting the woman who remained in his mind as the chosen one, he had been granted a new opportunity at self-re-education. Miss Serpa and Ernesto listened in amazement to this exposition on hearing beautiful logic concerning Evelina's anxious question as to what should do. Evelina clarified.
We can tell you, my sister, that because of your indisputable merit, your benefactors and friends in the higher realms prayed to the agents of divine justice not to allow your discarnation until you had begun your spiritual rehabilitation on earth itself. Thus, through the mental wave of your remorse in light of Mancini's supposed suicide, you attracted to your maternal womb the suffering spirit of a suicide who had been sentenced by his own conscience to go through the trial of a miscarriage in order to value with more respect the divine loan of physical existence. As we can see, the anguish of thwarted motherhood was extremely useful to you for having given you the opportunity to make priceless reparations. Let us pause. This is another big educational paragraph for us. The first thing is, he says, the maternal womb, it is the gift of the body and the gift of a miscarriage. The maternal womb represents the door to our redemption. It represents the door to our redemptive struggle, our spiritual rehabilitation, as he says, our restorative work. And it is why are we saying that? It is important for us to see life, which is the redemption, which is the redemptive struggle, which is the spiritual rehabilitation and restorative work. We need to see it for what it is. A lot of us in society, in the world, we think life needs to be playing games, a big party. We need to make the most of it. We need to celebrate, have fun, and do it at all cost. What we don't know, what we forget in some cases is life is meant to be a redemptive struggle. Why? Because due to the law of cause and effect, as you mentioned just a minute ago, Carol, we sow. What we sowed yesterday, we are reaping today. And what we're sowing today, we will be reaping in the future. None of us have a really clear conscience, none of us on earth. We've all done some things that we are here to undo. And in Thought and Life, in the chapter The Cradle, Emmanuel is so crystal clear. He's always so crystal clear, but here he's particularly clear to us to understand what life is. He says our cradle is the reflection of our needs. He doesn't say the cradle is the reflection of our wants. It's our needs, our moral legacy, in other words. He calls it our moral legacy, and that dictates what the family life looks like, the participants in our lives, our marriages, our encounters in life. It is all built on what we've done in the past, our moral legacy. And I pass it on to you, Carol, before we go to the physical body. I'm sure
okay.
There's something else. Yes.
Rihanna. Thank you, Rihanna, for asking us a great question. Rihanna is asking, could you explain the trial of miscarriage, please?
Yes.
Wonderful, wonderful question. In this particular case, of course, every case is a case, Rihanna. So neither Sunshine nor I have the perfect answer because each case is unique. But in the case of Evelina, as Dr. Rivas explains, that because she felt guilty for Julio's suicide, supposed suicide, she created a module of disturbance. Vibration, which is what Andrews explains in the book Evolution in Two Worlds. Every time we experience feelings of guilt or feelings that are very deeply seated, like anger, intemperance, guilt, cruelty, we create vibratory nodules and we attract disease situations that help us cleanse those nodules of disturbance away from our very spiritual body. So miscarriage, in the case of Evelina, Rihanna, helped her to flesh out the body, the physical body function as a filter to help her to flesh out the guilt that she was feeling regarding the supposed suicide. And God is so wonderful that at the same time that she redeemed her conscience and was able to find more peace within herself, she served as an instrument for a spirit who needed to undergo this trial of miscarriage. Most often, spirits who reincarnate or try to reincarnate and have this experience frustrated. This frustration is due to their not having been able to value life previously. So everything works in perfect harmony before God's love. Because God's love, God allowed the miscarriage to literally filter her guilt out, and at the same time to serve as instrument for a spirit who needed to value life more to undergo this opportunity of frustration in order to value life more. Does that help, Brianna? We hope so. And thank you to Eva Castro and Matthew Wolf for joining us as well. Shall we continue, Sunshine?
Yes, yeah, the physical body is a divine loan, it's a treasure. And some spirits, and a lot of us actually, are not really clear that, you know, it's really, it expresses in a magnificent work of divine wisdom. And we need to take care of our bodies. We need to really see it as our temple, our divine temple, to fulfill our mission here on life. And it starts with our diet, but it maybe it starts with our thinking, because all of this has an impact on our bodies. And it's the law of mental field, which is something to continuously be more aware of, right?
Yes, let's go on the thought guide. Positive thought guide. I like that from Shine. Beautiful.
Thank you, Carol.
So let us continue. Bob said, Patin, we were told that Maxine didn't commit suicide, but was shot by his rival instead.
Nevertheless, we should not forget that driven by Evelina's behavior, the young man lamentably had tried to kill himself once before, thereby giving Serpa the model for the crime. We
Smiling
are
benevolently, he
among friends examining the law of cause and effect. Let's remember that justice works within us.
but surprised Fantini hesitantly tried to reply. He wasn't sure as to how to weave his new question in light of their mentor's obviously rational explanation. It was Rufus himself who continued the thread of reasoning.
We are automatically driven to people and circumstances that are in tune with us or our problems. Shall we pause here?
Yes, sure. Please.
Yes, so we are driven to people that are in tune with our problems and in tune with us and our problems. Once again, it's the law of cause and effect. As we said earlier, the cradle really is our, it represents our moral legacy. We're all usually born on Earth in accordance with our debts and our needs, as Emmanuel taught us. So it is important that our family of origin, but also our universal family, it's important to know that we will encounter certain affections or geniuses or maybe problems because we have mutual deficiencies. It is all, as Emmanuel says in the book Thought and Life, thought stands as the mirror of life. And as we were thinking in previous incarnations, we spoke and acted as a result, and we planted seed in our gardens of immortality. And it is in this lifetime that we are reaping the harvest. The harvest is always compulsory. And consequently, we have certain things that we experience in our lives that are based on our own cause. It is we who co-created our reality by our thinking, our feeling, and as a result, our words and our actions. Right, Carol?
Yes, beautifully said, Sunshine. This is why the thought diet is so important. So
I like that.
co-create a better present and future for ourselves.
Yes.
Let us continue. Can you please help us see what Rebus has to tell us, Sunshine?
Yes. Where were we? By arousing ideas of self-destruction in the mind of a man whose attention she had won, Evelina moved from thoughtlessness to repentance when she realized his moral collapse and his failed conscious attempt at suicide. Only then, pressed by compassion, our sister understood that she had harmed the young man who had trusted her fully, and as a consequence, she had harmed herself as well. By grieving for Mancini, she deplored herself, and in that state of negative emotions, she became the vessel for a spirit in the condition she thought she had driven the unhappy man into. As a result, she automatically became the unfortunate mother of a suicide eager to expiate his own wrong. And here is the explanation that we were all looking for, right? Why she drew the miscarriage, the spirit of miscarriage, into her lives. It's the pure application of the law of attraction, the law of the mental field that is here materialized through the miscarriage she experienced. Right, Carol?
Right, Rian. So now you have an explanation by Instructor Rebus as well. Welcome, Soul Souls. Wonderful to have you here.
Our thoughts are like drip irrigation. Here on the West Coast, we deal with a lot of dryness. And so the picture I have is drip irrigation, just drip, drip, drip. Every thought creates either more bounty, more inner transformation towards the good, or we're creating nodules, and then they will have to be undone in the future.
Right. So Instructor Rebus, unfortunately, has more to tell us than shine.
Yes, let's go.
Let's go. There's more to learn.
By unconsciously expressing the desire to exculpate yourself, your purpose reached the hearts of friends and benefactors in the spirit world, and they obtained for you this blessed concession. So before discarnating, you suffered the punishment you felt you deserved, anxious to free Mancini from the harm you had caused him. And we know there is really no punishment, right? It is just the law of cause and effect. It's the effect she created from her actions. You didn't pay Tullio directly for the debt you had incurred. You paid it by helping a nameless suicide, as much as a child of God as we are, thereby redeeming yourself according to the law that governs a clear conscience. As for the unknown brother, when he suffered the trial of premature birth, he began to repay a debt he had assumed regarding himself, learning how precious it is and how much it costs to be granted the treasure of a physical body as a tool for spiritual growth and progress.
Ernesto and Eveline listened in surprise.
Eternal justice works itself out within us, finished the instructor. Eternal justice is in our hearts. It's a divine law. It is practicing justice is practicing the golden rule. Right, friends? Right, Carol?
Right.
Eternal justice always works itself out within us, the law of cause and effect. God neither condemns nor acquits us. Universal love is always ready to get us back on our feet. The love, universal love, which is what we mentioned earlier. It's the greatest sustenance for all. It's the balance of life on earth. Right, Carol?
Right, sunshine. Love is our moving force.
Yes. Universal love is always ready to get us back on our feet, to instruct, polish, uplift, and sanctify us. Destiny is the sum of our own actions and always has predictable results. We ourselves are the cause of the situations in which our existence is framed, because we get from life exactly what we put into it.
What now? Evelina asked, astonished.
Circumstances have brought your creditor to you because you, my sister, are luckily in a position to continue the restorative work.
What shall I do, my friend?
If you have really decided to renew your pathway, the time has come for you to help Mancini get rid of the sickly ideas that your behavior as an irresponsible girl planted in his mind. You can now be his dedicated tutor, helping him reformulate on the spirit plane his concepts of life.
I can't be his wife. Rebirth patted her hand, with paternal tenderness and replied,
if a woman's wrongs were not perpetrated as a partner of a man's sexual life, She has no obligation to be his wife just because she owes him this or that compensation as a spirit. The same applies to the man with regard to a woman. Notwithstanding this principle, the law of love must be fulfilled, regardless of the forms through which love is expressed. Shall we pause?
Yes, please, Sunshine. Beautiful teaching for us.
We are invited to practice the law of love. And what is the law of love? We're wondering, right, Kara? What is
right.
What actually, how does that look like if we want to practice it in our daily lives, which is the invitation that Instructor Rebus gives to us? Well, it is loving all brothers and sisters indiscriminately. Indiscriminately, which means even loving all those we don't approve of, all those who are criminals, those who are murderers, it doesn't matter who, we're all asked to love and accept all brothers and sisters. It is really an extension of loving our neighbor, which is loving our humankind. It is, Jesus told us over and over again, love your neighbor as yourself, which is loving whole of mankind as ourselves. It is practicing the golden rule. Do unto others as you would like them to do unto you. And then what happens if we practice the law of love? What is the effect, we're wondering? Why would we want to do that? It helps our own moral improvement. And by morally improving ourselves, we're helping the human race to morally improve. Because as we had heard earlier, is that our minds are always emitting. We're always emitting and we're always attracting. And everyone is influenced by others' minds. So consequently, if we educate ourselves, our hearts, our souls, our minds, our feelings, our will, which is really the CEO of our minds, is in charge, we educate ourselves, we become better people, and we stand, we let our light shine. And with that, we help others to let their light shine. We are the change we want to see, right, Carol?
Beautiful, Sunshine. And this goes hand in hand with the comment that Rihanna just shared with us, Sunshine. Rihanna
okay.
said, in the end, all trials are blessings. Well said,
yes.
Rihanna, because
beautiful.
Sunshine just explained to us.
Thank you.
God is
thank you.
Right? So there aren't such things as trials. Trials, what we tend to call trials, are learning opportunities that are consequences of God's mercy and of our own actions. So as spiritists, we are being invited by Instructor Rebus today to not hold any pity parties anymore, because we know that even the challenges that happen to us are educative opportunities for our own growth. We shall train ourselves to be grateful for the gifts in the skies, the blessings in the skies. This is why gratitude is a beautiful practice for us, as in it is in practicing gratitude and finding the blessings, as Rihanna is telling us, that we see the eternal love that has never left us. So God has never left us, but perhaps we in our journey chose to deviate from God here and there. So let us take this opportunity, dear friends, to embrace God's love by knowing that we are loved, and by counting our blessings, right, Sunshine?
Right, Carol, beautifully said. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you, Rihanna.
Yeah, thank you, Rihanna. Thank you.
And let us continue. see you, right, sunshine?
Yes, where were we? I lost it. Oh, here.
Yes.
Right here, you can be generate Tullio's emotional state and sublimate your own sentiments towards him by supporting and teaching him as a maternal m mentor. Almost always, a person's recovery is like a delicate plant within the soul, which only grows because the selflessness of someone else cares for it with tenderness and the dew of their tears. Evelina found her. It's your turn.
Yeah, Evelina found herself bathed in hope. Tacchini felt into deep meditation about eternal realities and Venus pranced by the schedule, calling him to other departments, promised to continue the instructive conversation as soon as they had the opportunity. So, dear friends, what a blessing it is for us to be given so many pills of hope now that we know that life is a continuum, that we are receiving the consequences of your very own actions, that our trials are blessings designed for our own growth. All we can do, sunshine, is be grateful. So shall we say a prayer of gratitude to God, dear friends and
Yes.
dear sunshine?
Yes, please, Carol.
All right. So if possible, dear friends, let's close our eyes and open our hearts in gratitude to our Mother, Father, God's infinite benevolence. We are so honored to be immersed in God's love. Now we understand that God's laws are not only just, but loving and merciful. We are so grateful for the opportunity to study together so we can boost each other's discernment. May our Master Jesus receive our infinite gratitude for having prepared in the name of God Allan Kardec to bring the philosophy of life, which teaches us that life goes on. We thank God, Master Jesus, Allan Kardec, for having lit the light of discernment through love in our hearts eternally. We pray for perseverance and effort to continue to nourish our souls so that we can follow our master's footsteps. We pray so that we finally and consciously choose good emotions and good thoughts, so that we can better co-create with God. We pray in gratitude, dear God, for the honor of co-creating with you and for the hope that you have given us today in this chapter, that you keep investing on our growth through immortality, through the gift of reincarnation, through the gift of life that always goes on. May the spirit doctor, Andre Luiz, also receive our utmost gratitude, Chico Xavier, and all the mentors who care for the progress of humanity, humbled for our opportunity to learn and to love. We ask for God's permission to end our study this afternoon, and so be it.
So be it.
Thank
Beautiful.
you.
Thank you, Carol. Thank you, Cardiac Radio.
Thank you, sunshine. Thank you, dear friend. Thank you, Victoria Baker, for Souza. Thank you, Lefty Wolf. Thank you, Teresa Calendar. Thank you, friends who we may not see, but to whom our hearts are in gratitude. Thank you, Kardec Radio friends who are listening to us. And if you listen to this on demand, may you be filled with the hope and the certainty that you are a beautiful child of God. Thank you, Sunshine.
Thank you all.
We will meet again next week at this time for more. Thank you, dear friends.